He was the perfect figure of the parochially important person in a state of defensive excitement. No doubt his speech appealed to many in the House. Of course, Lord Harcourt was quite right in saying that the character of the average House of Commons member will be changed by proportional representation. It will. It will make the election of obscure and unknown men, of carpetbag candidates who work a constituency as a hawker works a village, of local pomposities and village pump leaders almost impossible. It will replace such candidates by better known and more widely known men. It will make the House of Commons so much more a real gathering of the nation, so much more a House of Representative Men. Lord Harcourt's faddists and mugwumps. And it is perfectly true, as Mr. Ramsay MacDonald, also an opponent, declares, that proportional representation means constituencies so big that it will be impossible for a poor man to cultivate and work them. That is unquestionable. But mark another point. It will also make it useless, as Mr. Chamberlain has testified, for rich men to cultivate and work them. All this cultivating and working, all this going about and making things right with this little jobber here, that contractor there, all the squaring of small political clubs and organizations, all the subscription blackmail and charity bribery that now makes a parliamentary candidature so utterly rotten and influence of public life, will be killed dead by proportional representation. You cannot job men into parliament by proportional representation. Proportional representation lets in the outsider. It lets in the common, unassigned voter who isn't in the local clique. That is the clue to nearly all this opposition of the politicians. It makes democracy possible for the first time in modern history, and that poor man of Mr. Ramsay MacDonald's imagination, instead of caging about a constituency in order to start politician, will have to make good in some more useful way. As a leader of the workers in their practical affairs, for example, before people will hear him and begin to believe in him. The opposition to proportional representation of Mr. Sidney Webb and his little circle is a trifle more scientific in tone than these naive objections of the common run of antagonists, but underlying it is the same passionate desire to keep politics a close game for the politician and to bar out the politically unspecialized man. There is more conceit and less jobbery behind the criticisms of this type of mind. It is an opposition based on the idea that the common man is a fool who does not know what is good for him. So he has to be stampeded. Politics, according to this school, is a sort of cattle driving. The Webbites do not deny the broad facts of the case. Our present electoral system, with our big modern constituencies of thousands of voters, leads to huge turnovers of political power with a relatively small shifting of public opinion. It makes a mock of public opinion by caricature, and Parliament becomes the distorting mirror of the nation. Under some loud false issue, a few score of thousands of votes turn over, and in goes this party or that with a big sham of majority. This the Webbites admit, but they applaud it. It gives us, they say, a strong government. Public opinion, the intelligent man outside the House, is ruled out of the game. He has no power of intervention at all. The artful little Fabian politicians rub their hands and say, "Now we can get to work with the wires. No one can stop us." And when the public complains of the results, there is always the repartee. "You elected them." But the Fabian psychology is the psychology of a very small group of pedants who believe that fair ends may be reached by foul means. It is much easier and more natural to serve foul ends by foul means. In practice, it is not tricky benevolence, but tricky bargaining among the interests that will secure control of the political wires.